Chapter 42, Succession. This chapter consists of 13 sections. Section 1, the first thing to be done with what is left, that is, what is found of the deceased estate, and the number of days during which the heirs are protected from claims attached to their inheritance. The cost of wrapping the dead body, the wages of the gravediggers, and the price of the grave shall be deducted initially. Provisions regarding the expenses of the funeral and the celebration of the fixed number of masses which follow the funeral are found in the chapter of the dead. After the said expenses, you shall give from the estate of the deceased to the poor, so that it may be a commemoration for him. Gloss, which is found in the canons of the apostles, and which is the precept of Peter, Paul, and James. They shall give alms to the poor from the property of the deceased who were good Christians, but not from the estates of the apostates and the wicked. And so in Canon 60. The following is found in the canons of the kings. The one for whom the day of his death has arrived must leave something from his property by will to the poor, so that he may have remuneration on the day of judgment. A man shall not leave anything except that which he gained justly. The tributes and debts which are imputable to the deceased should then be paid from the estate. If the property left is not sufficient to pay off the debts, the heir shall not pay the debt and the loan incurred by the deceased if he does not take the inheritance. If the heir accepts the inheritance, he must keep it separate, put the amount in writing, and show the amount to the creditors. He shall give to each in proportion to what is due to him. And if he accepts the inheritance and spends it by giving it away to others or in some such way, or if he hides it and does not reveal where it is, it is serious that the creditors remain deprived of their belongings, or if he has given them only half of it, then he must pay all that is due to them after the debt is ascertained by a reliable witness. After the payment of the above debt, the deceased has contracted with God, as by a vow, shall be discharged. And after this, the heirs shall fulfill the precept of the law. We have dealt already with the testator, saying that in his will he may not dispose of more than a half and a fourth part of what he owns. The fourth part shall be set aside for the one who is entitled to inherit it, and the testator may not dispose of it. None may claim anything from the heirs of the deceased, or from his family, or from his guarantors, before the end of the 9 days during which the heirs are in mourning. None shall harm them in any way, or produce them before a tribunal, either for a loan or a debt incurred by the deceased, or sue them for other causes. And if before 9 days expire, there is one who dares sue one of them, or to use violence against them, or their guarantor, by taking any of their property, his act is void. But after the lapse of the said time, one may sue them in accordance with the law. Section 2. The complete exposition explaining the provisions on succession and the order of the heir's degree. There are two ways of coming into succession. The first regards the one to whom, with other heirs, a specific portion is left by will. The provisions regarding this way are 6 in number. Half of the estate goes to the wife and the heirs of her husband, if the heirs are not her children. If they are her children, her share shall be equal to that of each one of the children, and the children shall get equal shares. The same rule applies to the husband. The brothers of the deceased receive a third part, together with his mother. The same rule holds true in the case of their children, who shall inherit with the mother. Similarly, the grandfather of the deceased and the paternal grandmother are entitled to a third part of the estate together with his brothers and sisters. As for the second way, the estate is assigned to the relatives and to the paternal family, males and females, prior to the maternal relatives, and the number of the heir's degree shall be as provided in the canons of the kings and the complete determination laid down by law. There is nothing which has not been mentioned in the canons. As is said in the canons, the degrees are 22 in number. First degree, the children of the deceased, males and females equally. Second, male and female, children of the male, children equally, each one according to his degree, degree after degree. Third, the father. Fourth, blood brothers of the deceased, his sisters and his mother equally. Fifth, the half-brothers and half-sisters who are from the side of the father. Sixth, the half-brothers and half-sisters who are from the side of the mother. Seventh, the male and female children of the deceased brothers equally. Eighth, the male and female children of their male children, each one according to his degree, degree after degree. Ninth, the father of the deceased father. Tenth, the mother of the deceased father. 11th, the father's brother. 12th, the male and female children of the father's brother equally, each one according to his degree, degree after degree. 13th, the male and female children of the deceased daughters equally, each one according to his degree, degree after degree. 14th, the male and female children of the deceased sisters equally, each one according to his degree, degree after degree. 15, the male and female children of his sister's children equally, each one according to his degree, degree after degree. 16th, the male and female children of the father's brother's children, each one according to his degree, degree after degree. 17th, the sisters of the deceased father and their male and female children equally, each one according to his degree, degree after degree. 18th, the father of the deceased mother. 19th, the mother of his mother. 20th, the brothers of the deceased mother, their male and female children equally, each one according to his degree, degree after degree. 21st, the sisters of the deceased mother, their male and female children equally, each one according to his degree, degree after degree. 22nd, the parents of the grandparents, after them, the near relatives of the far relatives, since the law of succession proceeds in such a way that the close relatives and removed relatives may inherit. You shall give priority to the degree of the deceased children and to their children over the degree of the deceased father. You shall also give priority to the relatives of the father over those of the mother. And males shall inherit before females in the degree of the father's brothers and of the mother's brothers and the grandparents. The above mentioned males and females shall be equal, and those who are full brothers shall inherit before those who are not full brothers. Each degree of the fixed and arranged degrees which we spoke of above is distinguished in order that one of those who should come after will not inherit together with those who should come before, unless he is called by the will to inherit with them. And if there is one who is distinguished from these heirs, he shall inherit all the property of the one who has appointed him as the universal heir. And if an heir is united with the others by will, he shall take what remains after the will has been satisfied. Section 3. On what a husband inherits from his wife and a wife from her husband. The reason for the precedence of a husband and a wife is being called to the succession is that they are the source of others. By virtue of their union in accordance with the law of marriage, by marriage children are born and parents are called fathers, and by marriage they are one flesh only, as God has said, one is entitled to the property of the other. Gloss. It is known that this succession as between wife and husband takes place if there are no parents, grandparents, children, grandchildren, brothers, fathers of mother's brothers, or children of any of them. If a husband or a wife dies without having written a will, and does not have a natural heir among either his ascendants, his descendants, or his collaterals, then the husband is entitled to all the wife's property, and similarly, the wife is entitled to her husband's property. At the end of his collection, the patriarch Abba Gabriel has said, "If there is a wife who has children, she shall be counted as one of them, because the Didascalia has said, 'Give the orphans the property of their parents and the widows the property of their husbands.' This statement says to give the inheritance of the deceased to his children and to his wife. If no distinction is made in the amount to be given to each, they will all be equal. And also, If one of the married pairs dies and leaves heirs other than his wife, but has no children to succeed him, it is customary that half of the property which he left go to his wife and the other half to those who are entitled to inherit. This custom is also in accord with what is said in Mac 51. As for those who are betrothed, if a man is betrothed to a woman and dies before marrying her, half of the property he previously gave her shall belong to her, and the other half to his relatives. But if he has no heirs besides her, she shall have all the property. At the end of his collection, in part 2, the patriarch Abba Gabriel has said, "This rule and teachings like it shall be applied to one of the two as well as to the other, because God has said to man, 'Let us make for him one who may help him.' And also he said that they shall be only one flesh and not two. The husband shall inherit from his wife in the same manner as is established for her inheritance from him. That is, she takes half of her husband's estate and the other half goes to his relatives, provided that there are no children. But if they have children, the wife and the children shall have equal shares. And if they have neither children nor relatives, the wife shall inherit everything. If between the husband and the wife there is a relationship by consanguinity, the provisions of the quantity shall be that each one of the two shall inherit from the other two parts, one part because of marriage and the other part because of relationship." And in the chapter of the law of marriage, there is another canon. It is Mac 51. If the husband dies, the wife shall keep all her wedding outfit and half of her dowry. And if the wife dies and the husband survives, he shall have all her dowry and half of the wedding outfit she bought, whether the wife had children from him or not. If the husband dies and the wife has not had children from him, she shall have her wedding outfit and half of her dowry. If her outfit is old and spoiled, she shall receive the price of the dresses which she brought with her on the basis of the value the dresses had when she came wearing them. And if nothing remains of the outfit, the writing which shows the amount of the price shall be consulted. The price shall be known from the writing between them, both as the dress which was dyed and whose price is known, and as to the other objects which she brought. If among her dowry there were men and women slaves, she shall take them if they are alive. If they have been sold, she shall take the price. But if they are dead, she shall not take the price, nor any ransom, since they are mortal by their nature. If the men and women slaves have children, she shall take half of their children. The other half shall go to the heirs or her husband. In the same way, if she has brought with her a flock of sheep or cows or other animals which multiply, they shall belong to the wife if they are alive and have not multiplied. But if they have multiplied, she shall take half of those born. And if those she brought originally are dead, she shall take half of their offspring. The same disposition holds true for bees and similar things. Gloss from the Book of the Kings. Half of the animals born must go to the husband, because the expenses necessary for maintenance of the beasts were taken from his belongings. If one of the betrothed couple dies before marriage, the provision concerning him has already been laid down in the second part of the chapter on marriage, on the earnest of the betrothed couple. Section 4, on the rule of succession, which is made up of 2 degrees. First degree, on the children who inherit from their father, which is the first degree of the heirs. The reason why the deceased children are given priority over his parents in inheriting the property is that the parents are the cause of the coming forth of their children and of their existence. The cause of their existence must be also the cause of their welfare. This welfare is attained by wealth, and also because the children who receive life hope to live while their grandparents are about to be separated from life, since with its advantages is maintained with health. Then the children are more entitled to be called the succession than their grandparents. For this reason, the succession goes down from the ascendants to the descendants and does not go back from the descendants to the ascendants unless there are no descendants and will be no descendants for a long time. Gloss. It is known that the old in age die before the young, because it is a law of nature. And also, since the memory of the fathers lives through their children, then it is proper that the latter inherit from the former. The reason why the daughter is entitled to inherit as well as the son is found in the New Testament and not in the Old Testament. Apostle Paul has said that man and woman are only one thing in Christ. In being called to the succession, they are also equal. Their equality lies in the fact that they have an equal relationship of filiation. The portion of each child must be like that of each other. The reason for the priority of children over the children's children is that the former are closer than the latter. Whenever one dies intestate and leaves children, the males and females shall inherit in equal measure, be they full brothers and sisters of the same father and mother or not, be one of them deaf or dumb or not, or be they close or not. If a daughter marries after she has taken her wedding outfit from her parents, her outfit shall be considered as part of her share regardless of whether the father stipulated so during his lifetime or not. And it is agreed in the church that if the outfit is worth more than her share of inheritance, she shall not demand anything more. If it is less, she shall take something to make it up. One who is born from a free woman after the writing of the will shall inherit with his brothers and shall be considered as one of them. And those who are born from a sinful marriage, like a union with a brother's wife, a wife's sister, a father's sister, a mother's sister, or a father's wife or concubine, shall not inherit anything from their fathers except by a written will. Those who inherit from the father are the children born from a lawful wife. This is permitted. And if the father leaves anything to the children born from an unlawful union in his will and wishes to make them inherit together with their brothers in equal measure, he is allowed to do so. Second degree, the succession of the male and the female children of male children to the estate of their grandparents. The children's children, both male and female, shall inherit from their grandparents and must object to the parents of their grandparents succeeding the latter. If a grandparent who has a living son dies, and if besides him there are another predeceased son, the children of his dead son shall succeed to that portion which would have gone to their father, and shall take what their father would have taken if he were alive, regardless whether they are males or females, and regardless whether they are under guardianship or not. This is a law which is not observed in our church, as what is said in the source is better than what is said in this gloss, in that his children are closer to him than the children of his children, and the estate should go to the one who is closer. Section 5. The succession of a father to his children. This is the third degree, because a father comes before the deceased brothers. This precedence is due to the fact that he is closer than the others. Between father and children, there is only one degree, whereas between brother and brother, there are two degrees, that is, two generations. Moreover, the father is the cause of the existence of both the child and the property. He is the source of the existence of persons who are entitled to inherit his property, while the brother is not the cause of the existence of his brother. The father, who is the origin of the property, is entitled to take it, and also the main part must go to the father because he is the one who has given this property to his son. It is right that it come back to him. But for this reason also, it is right to give preference to the father rather than to the mother. Also because woman has been created for man, and what is created for the benefit of another is inferior to the latter in honor. And because a mother is considered as the recipient, as the earth with respect to the seed, the more so as the wealth returns to the brother who is the successor to the paternal line. And this is the reason for the priority of the father over the brothers and the mother. If one dies and has no children or children's children and has not left a will, but is survived by his father and mother, only his father shall succeed him. Section 6. It comprises four degrees. the succession as between full brothers and sisters, the succession of those who are not full brothers, the disposition regarding the grandparents with respect to the brother and sister, and the succession of the mother, and the rules concerning her, and the succession of the brother's children. The deceased brothers are placed next to the father because they are his sons, and his sons are closer to him than others. This is the reason why priority is given to the brothers over the grandparents, since the deceased and his brothers are equal in the relationship which is closer to the father and is a relationship of affiliation. The relationship of the grandparents towards the son of the deceased is one of paternity, and in the will, the relationship of filiation precedes that of paternity when it comes to succession. Also, because the grandparents are near to parting from this life, and the children of their children, who are the brothers of the deceased, are expected to live longer, it is the latter who have a greater need for the wealth. Fourth degree. If there is a deceased who leaves neither children nor father, his brothers, sisters, and mother shall inherit his property. The mother's share is equal to that of her children. The full brothers and sisters, who are those born from the same father and mother, shall get equal shares. Fifth and sixth degrees. If the deceased has no full brothers, his estate shall go to his brothers born from a different mother or father. The reason for this is that those who are his relatives by full brotherhood, being closer than those who are not born from the same parents, deserve to succeed him before others whose relationship is not complete. The brother on the father's side shall have priority over the brother on the mother's side, because the former is related to the deceased in the first degree. If the deceased has no living parents or wife, the grandfather and grandmother shall succeed him together with his brothers and sisters, all three of them. In this canon, the distinction between the paternal grandparents and the maternal grandparents is not made, but the canon on succession gives priority to the paternal grandparents over the maternal grandparents, and it is right that the paternal grandparents be given such a priority over the maternal grandparents in this chapter. But this rule is applied only where the brothers are of one father and mother. If they are brothers on the father's side only the paternal grandparents shall inherit from the deceased. And if they are brothers on the mother's side only the maternal grandparents shall inherit from him. And as the mother of the deceased is considered as one of his brothers and sisters, none of them shall prevent her from taking her share. Be they of the same father and mother or not, she shall inherit together with them, as if she were one of them. If there is no heir from among them, the sister shall inherit in place of her brother. The children of the deceased brothers shall be barred from inheriting her share, because the canon provides that she must be treated on the same footing as one of the brothers. The brother shall forbid his children to claim the share allotted to his sister also, because she is closer to the grandparent. The mother with the father's brother and the children of the father's brother, all three shall share equally. Seventh degree. The rule which provides the priority should be given to the one who is the deceased father's closest relative and appropriate. It is known that the child's child succeeds after the child, and that the child of the father's brother must be called to the succession after the father's brother. The male and females born to the children of the deceased brothers shall inherit equal shares after the deceased brothers and sisters, as is established for the brothers. The priority of full brothers born from the same father and mother over those who are not full brothers, and the priority of the brothers on the father's side over those on the mother's side is clear from what has been said. The rule that shows that the brothers' children inherit after them is laid down. If the deceased had a brother from the same father and mother, and if this brother has left children, these children shall inherit with the brothers of their father, that is, with the full brothers of the deceased, and shall have the portion of their father, and take what their father would have taken if he were living. They shall have priority over the brothers who are not from the same father and mother. This rule is not observed because the brothers are closer to a brother than their children, and the closer relative has priority over the more distant. Section 7. In this section, there are two degrees, the 8th and the 9th. It is on what the paternal grandfather and grandmother of the deceased inherit. The reason for giving priority to the paternal grandparents over the father's brothers is by the fact that the former are closer, because between the grandfather and his son's children there are two generations, while between the father's brother and his brother's children there are three generations, as has been demonstrated in the chapter on marriage from the Aptilis with regard to the paternal grandparents and the maternal grandparents. The father's relatives have priority over the mother's relatives. If there are no heirs in the descendant line, the ascendants precede the collateral relatives on either side, unless these relatives are the deceased brothers. After the males, the females related to the deceased father shall be called to the succession, and after them the relatives of the mother. The aforesaid distinction found in the two written canons states that the estate goes to the paternal grandfather of the deceased after his brothers and provides for the precedence of the paternal grandfather over the maternal grandfather. Section 8. It has two degrees, the 10th and the 11th. On the succession of the brothers of the deceased fathers and of the children of the father's brother, and the provisions concerning them together with their mother. The reason for priority of the deceased father's brother and of the children's over the deceased father's sister and the sister's children is that the latter cross over from the family of the father to that of the woman, that is, to their respective mothers. One who has left no children, parents, grandparents, brothers, brother's child, or wife, shall have for his heirs his father's brothers, and if he has no father's brothers, he shall have the children of the father's brothers for his heirs. The father's brothers and the children of the father's brothers with the deceased mother, all three shall share the inheritance. A third part shall go to the uncles and cousins, and the mother shall have two-thirds. If there are no brothers or brothers' children, because the inheritance goes to the surviving person from each side of the relationship. In each degree, the closest relatives shall inherit, and if several heirs are found in only one degree, they shall inherit equally. Section 9. It has two degrees, the 12th and the 13th, how the deceased daughter's children and his sister's children inherit. If there are neither brothers, brothers' children, father's brothers, nor children of the father's brothers, the daughter's children shall inherit from the deceased, and if his daughters have no children, the sister's children shall inherit from him. Section 10. The remaining degrees are found in this section. If the deceased has left no child, parents, brother, brother's child, or sister's child, the sister of his father shall succeed him. But if there are no father's sisters, their children shall succeed him, and this is the first degree, wherein the male and female children of a man are treated equally, while in the second degree and the following degrees, women and their children are not entitled to inherit with their brothers nor with the children of their brothers. Women more removed than the first degree are barred from succeeding, and the children of the females shall not inherit with the children of the males, nor the sister's children with the brother's children, nor the children of the father's sister with the children of the father's brothers, nor the children of the mother's sisters with the children of the mother's brothers. But where the male line of the father runs out, the descendants born from the females shall be called to the succession. And where there are no more relatives born from the females of the paternal side, then the family of the mother shall be called to the succession. And as it has been said in the provisions of the law, after the father's sisters, the family of the mother, that is, the father of the mother of the deceased, and after him, her mother, shall be called to the succession, and after her, the brother of the mother. Because between the deceased and his grandfather, there are two generations, while between him and the mother's brother, there are three generations. And after the mother's brother, the children of the mother's brother, male and female, shall be called to succeed, as in the case of the children of the father's brother, who succeeded after the father's brother. After the children of the mother's brothers and the sister of the deceased mother's, and after her, her children, male and females, and after them, the parents of the grandparents, shall be called to the succession. And so it is And so it goes in accordance with what has been said already. As for one who has no heirs, the goods he leaves shall go to the public treasury. Section 11. On the succession of bishops and monks. The property belonging to the bishop shall be distinctly identified, and the property which belongs to the church shall be kept separate, so that the bishop may have power over all his property, use it as he wishes, and bequeath it to the person he likes, unless he loses property because of the property of the church. And if the bishop has relatives or children, this behavior is held to be just before this behavior is held to be just before God, that is, that nothing of the church's property should be lost, and that he shall not give the property of the church to the use of someone he likes. No one shall use violence against the bishop because of his property. The people of his house and his relatives shall not quarrel with the priests and deacons on account of his property and the goods of the church, lest the dispute bring about shame, dishonor, strain, and a bad name after his death. The bishop's property shall be kept separate, lest his relatives fall into difficulty and curse him. Whatever the bishop owns before his elevation to the episcopacy, he may give it to anyone he likes. He may dispose of it, and dispose of it by will. But whatever he acquired after he was appointed bishop must belong to the church. He is not allowed to dispose of any part of it, but may dispose of what he inherits from his parents, his brothers, or his father's brothers. If a person was poor at the time he was made a bishop, and acquired wealth after his appointment, it is obvious that what he has acquired belongs to the church. After his death, it shall belong to the church. However, his children shall not be deprived of what may be given to them from the goods of the church as alms by reasoning that they are not entitled to the goods of the church as inheritance. Especially if the bishop has poor relatives, the necessities of life shall be given them from the goods of the church. A person who has children and becomes a monk may divide all his property among his children, and shall keep for himself a part which shall belong to the monastery. If he dies intestate, the children shall take what they are entitled to without the will. They are called heirs, and he is called felkedon. The rest shall be given to the monastery. If he has no children and has not brought his property to the monastery, he is the master in his will. But if he has brought his property to the monastery and has said, "Let my property enter the monastery," his property shall belong to the monastery pursuant to what he commanded before entering the monastery. Section 12. On slaves and those who are manumitted. A slave shall not inherit except by the will of a person who appoints him his heirs, because inheritance goes only to relatives. Moreover, no one except his master can succeed him, because he is a thing belonging to his master. Therefore, a will or a contract of sale made by him is not valid unless permitted by his master. If a slave wishes to marry a woman slave after his manumission and begets children from her, our law commands that his children born from the slave shall not succeed him. His property shall belong to his master, who manumitted him. Similarly, the child of a manumitted woman born from a slave shall not inherit from her. Rather, the one from among the free persons who has a right to succeed her shall inherit for her, and to her husband shall be given that which is his share. The estate left by the master cannot be assigned to the slave, because in the will the slave is an object belonging to the master. If one leaves an estate which goes to the royal treasury because he has no heirs, and if slaves from part of the estate, they shall be set free forthwith, and they shall be free. Even if all he left are slaves, they shall be freed, and the one who transgresses this order shall not find absolution from his sins. As for one who is manumitted, the succession to his estate shall be governed by the provisions on succession found in the Aptilisat, and similar canons. That is, he may make a valid will. If he himself has heirs, let the heirs inherit. But if he has no heirs, and has appointed as his heirs a person other than the one who manumitted him, the third part shall nevertheless go to his manumitted. manumitter. And if the amount he disposed of by will is less than a third of what he owns, the rest shall go to his manumitter. If he has not made a will, whatever he owns shall go to the manumitter, regardless of whether the person manumitted is one or more than one. And then the heirs of the manumitter shall inherit from the manumitted in the manner in which they inherit from the manumitter. If a slave is manumitted in writing, and it is clearly stated that the slave, together with his property, is set free, he shall be free. But if no mention was made of, property, and only the slave was actually manumitted, the heirs of the manumitter shall inherit the property of the one who is manumitted. Section 13. Those who may not inherit, and those from whom one may not inherit anything. Those who may not inherit without a will are those who are not related to the deceased by a natural relationship or marriage, even if they are related by agreement or by law, such as the relationship of governess, wet nurse, friends, or godparent, or relationship by marriage, such as the mother's husband or the father's wives, the husband's relatives, the wife's relatives, the son's half-brothers and half-sisters, the brother's and sister's parents, the brother's wife, the sister's husband, the son's wives, and the daughter's husbands. Regarding those from whom one may not inherit, there are two parts. Part 1. One who falls under the first classification shall not inherit even when the will is made in his favor. An apostate shall not inherit from a Christian even if the latter made a will in his favor, and the former defected from the faith after the will was made, but before taking what was bequeathed to him. If it is known that he came back to the true faith, he shall receive his share of the estate. If he embraces another faith after the partition of the estate, he shall not inherit anything, even if he was called to succeed by the will. If the testator is a priest, his heirs must be Christian. If among his relatives there is no Christian, his estate shall go to the church in which he served as a priest. If he was not a priest and has no heirs, but was a Christian, his property shall be brought to the royal treasury. And the killer of the bequeather shall not inherit whether he himself killed him or delivered him to another person who did kill him. And he who schemes against the life of the bequeather with poison or similar things shall not succeed him. Part 2. Of those who cannot inherit without a will by the one who leaves an estate. These are the children of the relatives born from an unlawful wife, just as was said earlier with respect to slaves. Freed slaves and dissolute children who despise the insult and insult the bequeather or dishonor him by abandoning his mode of life for some evil way of life, like that of a juggler or sorcerer, and those who fornicate with the wife of the bequeather, or with his daughter, or with his sister, or with his mother, and those who bring charges against him to make him lose his wealth, all these shall not succeed him without his written will. And a woman who gets married before the expiration of the days fixed by the law, or one who hides the will pursuant to what is said in the chapter on marriage, all these must be barred by the testator from what they would be eligible to inherit according to their degree. The dissolute son who beats his parents, insults them continuously, falsely accuses them, distresses them by his faults, does not obey them, causes them trouble, and leads them to people who are not believers, accuses them, makes each one of them debtors, or where his parents are afflicted with chronic illness and have become old and feeble, does not care to help them as best as he can, this son shall be disinherited. And if one of them is in prison or in trouble, and the son refuses to act as guarantor when requested to by one of his parents, despite the fact that he is their male child, or if he uses violence to obstruct the parents from making their will, or if he associates with dissolute people against the advice of his parents and persists in this type of behavior, then his father shall not be called his father, nor shall he be his son under these circumstances. But the same token, the daughter, sister, mother, and other person shall be disinherited if they associate with fornicators, or If one of the parents wishes to get a husband for his daughter or for the daughter of his son and gives them the wedding outfit he cannot afford to give, but they refuse to get married and wish to lead a dissolute life. And if one of the parents becomes demented and all the children or some of them do not take care of him, or if he has no children and seeks help from those who are not his relatives but succeed him even if he dies intestate, and they do not take care of him, the later on he separates himself happily from his sickness, he has the power after this, at any time he wishes, to write a will by which he disinherits those children and relatives who neglected him in the time of his trouble, as a punishment for the rejection of his wealth. If a non-relative sees him being neglected by his relatives during his sickness, pities him, and wants to take care of him, he shall tell them to keep him and to take care of him. If they do not answer him, and the non-relative takes him to his house, and it is known that he paid for the sick man's maintenance with his own money until the day of the latter's death, he shall get a share of the estate as one of those entitled to succeed the deceased. Similarly, if one of the parents is exiled or imprisoned, and all the children, or some of them, do not hurry to free him to the extent they can, he must, once he is freed, confirm their disinheritance when he makes his will. He shall not appoint them as heirs if, because of their negligence, they did not rescue him from prison. And if he dies in prison, they shall not succeed him because they were careless. His estate shall be given to the church, and shall be used for the rescue of prisoners until they are freed by it. The estate shall be used carefully for rescuing others. If the prisoner has no children, and if those who share his estate in the absence of a will are indolent and do not hasten to free him, so much so that he dies in prison, his estate shall be given to none of those who neglected him before his imprisonment, even if he had made a will in their favor. This applies equally to the non-relative whom the prisoner had appointed as his heir before his imprisonment. If he, aware of the fact that he was his heir, did not bother to release him from prison, and if he is over 18 years of age, this punishment is well deserved, with regard to whatever was sold from his property, or was acquired upon pledge or borrowed to secure his release. To do this in a good and valid thing, the one who comes back from captivity must pay and return it, because it was done for his release and benefit. If the heir gave to the testator medicine that injured his intelligence, or if the testator was killed or taken prisoner as a result of the heir's failure to give him help while he could give it, and was asked to, the heir, after these facts, shall not inherit anything, nor shall he take what was assigned to him in the testator's will. But if he is an heir who could not give him help, because he is dumb, deaf, sick, or demented, he shall not be prevented from having his inheritance. Whatever has been said to the applicable to children with respect to their parents applied to parents with respect to their children, but there's a provision applicable to both the testator and their heirs, of whatever degree the latter may be, that forbids disinheritance if there is no reason to disinherit relatives or non-relatives after the will is made. One who is not an heir at law shall not have priority over an heir at law. The other provisions deal with fornicators and is found in the Aptilisat. Other provisions similar to the above are added to them. The following are cases which must be ruled by analogy. There are no specific provisions dealing with them. These cases are divided into two parts. First, if two or three heirs die on a journey or were buried by a house that fell down upon them, or if they are wrecked at sea, or were burnt by fire, or if some of them die because of one of these causes or because of some other cause, and especially if it is not known who died first and who died next, No one of them shall succeed any of them. No one shall succeed them except those from among the living who have the right to succeed them and not the dead, as it is not known which of them died first and which died next. The second part forbids taking possessions of the property of people who are not known to be alive, such as people who are in prison or on a journey, since their condition, that is, whether they are alive or dead, is doubtful. In particular, the property of persons about whom there is no news shall not be divided without preceding reliable evidence to prove their death. If a long time has passed since they set out on a journey, the judge shall decide that one who has been absent for such a long period of time cannot be alive. If a person's relative dies at home while the person is absent, the relative's estate shall be divided in the person's absence, as and his share shall be put aside. He loses his share only when it is certain that he is not still alive, because the people ordinarily die before this age. For instance, if a person who is on a journey has a son and a nephew of the former dies while his son is at home, the latter may not inherit his cousin's property while his father is alive, but must preserve the father's share until reliable news is received about his father, until a decision based on sure knowledge is given on the matter, or the like. Chapter 43. The Judge and What Concerns Him and Witnesses. This chapter is made up of 13 sections taken from what was written in the laws, which are considered as roots and branches, and from the collection of appendices arrived at through perfect reasoning. Section 1. The Appointment of a Judge. The judge is the highest priest, that is, the patriarch or the bishop, and those among the priests ranking next to them and worthy of being appointed judges in their stead. The appointment of a judge is required by the law and by nature. With respect to the first, the highest God has said in Book 5 of the Pentateuch, "In all your cities which the Lord your God will give you, you shall appoint judges, so that they may deliver just judgments, and they shall not yield to either party at the time of judgment, nor shall they make distinction between person and person, nor accept the bribes, because bribes blind the eyes of the wise, so much so that they cannot see the justice and alter the just word." Nature requires the appointment of judges because a community cannot live without there arising disputes caused by various matters. These disputes cannot be settled without a judge to arbitrate between the litigants, the strong and the weak, the intelligent and the fool, to see to it that justice is done. The Holy Book shows that in case one defies the order of the judge, he must be brought before him, and the provisions dealing with this are laid down in the command of the law. The necessity of appointing judges is also apparent, since the provisions regarding the appointment of judges are dealt with in the canons providing for the appointment of priest and archpriest. It is essential now to lay down here the provisions regarding the office of a judge and those which render his appointment fair and his decisions valid. These provisions are 13 in number. First, he must be a man. This implies that he has attained virility, by which is meant that he is no longer a youth, because if he has not attained this age, he is not mature mentally and is not fit to be appointed to adjudicate between the young and the old and those like them. It is not good that such people come before a youth and that he rule for them and against them. For them means those who are winners in the suit, against them means the losers. The requirement of being a male is based on the consideration that man is the master of woman, as said by the apostle. The office of a judge belongs to the superior rather than to the subordinate. Because a man is more intelligent, he must judge. As asserted by the canons, a woman shall not teach, nor shall be made a member of the clergy, and no person other than a member of the clergy shall be appointed a judge. The second condition is intelligence together with knowledge. One form of knowledge is innate and the other is acquired by studies. To be a judge, it is not enough to search for knowledge, nor is it enough to be devoted to the study of doctrine and strive to acquire what is necessary to carry out the duties of a judge. He must also be one who is gifted enough to discern and distinguish between the questions intelligently, far from blindness, and subtle enough to solve difficult and obscure cases, since such a judge may judge between the wise and the wicked. He must not be less intelligent than the litigants, or one who has scanty knowledge. Thirdly, he must be an orthodox Christian and a priest conversant with his duties. The fourth condition is that he have the fairness required from judges and witnesses. As regards the first, he must be loyal, wise, irreproachable, without blemish, slow both to pardon and to follow the impulse of his will, patient in anger, fearful of God, upright in his faith during the time he holds the office of judge. For he who has faith, uprightness, and purity may judge over the illiterate and women, and rule on cases involving the property of orphans and those under tutelage. An impartial, mild, and patient judge shall not be despised, nor shall his judgments be looked upon with contempt, since by doing these things they may provoke him to anger. With respect to the fairness required of witnesses, the section devoted to them deals with them. The fifth condition is that a judge must be a free man, because he who has no power over himself has no power over others. The sixth condition is that he must have sound hearing and sight, so that he may distinguish between the true and the false word. The seventh condition is that he must be able to speak clearly, and must know the difficult languages which are spoken by the people of his jurisdiction when they argue before him. The eighth condition is that he be free of any illness, such as leprosy, which would keep away many people who have to come to him, since witnesses must be able to come to and stay before his court, and others must come to be adjured by him. The ninth condition is that he must know the law and the rules of procedure in the roots and in the branches. The roots are four. First, he must know the word of the divine books, read and interpret them according to their exact meaning, with a knowledge that includes understanding of what is contained in the interpretation regarding the rules of judging, in their textual reading and in their original interpretation. Two, he must know the contents of the accepted books wherein the teachings and deeds of the apostles are found, and also the teachings of the holy councils and the saintly fathers, so that he may follow their teachings and imitate their deeds, since all this knowledge leads to sound judgment. Three, he must know on what questions the collections of canons and the saintly and learned fathers agreed, and on what matters they differed, so that he may follow what is certain and strive to think for himself on the disputed question, and thus confirm what is more certain and closer to question on which the fathers agreed. Four, he must be able to draw analogies by which one may obtain the ability of connecting the branches which are required and which silence any objection to the roots from which they sprouted. And the assembly of the fathers was held to interpret the roots and the branches, and to facilitate the process of arriving at the proper decision of question that arises, each in its own way. He who is served in these four fundamentals can be considered as one of the able judges who discharges his duties with insight and intelligence, and is entitled to interpret the book and to pass judgments. The tenth condition is that the superior judge who appoints another must learn whether the one he appoints meets these requirements, either by becoming familiar with his life story, or by choosing him from among others, or by inquiring about him and asking those who know him. 11th condition, the person who is appointed by a written document authorizing him to take up the duties of a judge and to exercise them permanently is duly appointed. This authorization shall be made public by announcing it to the people. The 12th condition is that once he has received the document authorizing his appointment, he must spread his teaching by his words and by his ruling, as well as by his example. The 13th condition is that all those who are under his jurisdiction, or the greater part of them, shall not be prevented from coming to him, nor shall those in his jurisdiction, nor the majority of them, oppose his appointment. Section 2. On his powers. If his jurisdiction is general, he may rule on seven different matters. These are, first, to settle disputes and put an end to quarrels, either peacefully and amicably, upon the party's agreement or by force, striking fear into them. Second, he may give back property to its owner when his title of property has been proved by the confession of the accused or by the testimony of witnesses. Third, he may appoint a guardian for one who is incapable of administering his property, either because he is a minor, because he is deprived of the use of reason, or because he is a prodigal, so that his property may be looked after properly and to assure a sound judgment by the judge. Fourth, he must know the time for the accounting of a charitable legacy in order to watch over the root and distinguish the branches, to take what is yielded from it and use it for the appointed purposes. If the beneficiary of the legacy is worthy of administering it, he himself shall keep it. Otherwise, the judge shall appoint another. Then he will be informed as to the deposit under the care of the administrators, and also as to the affairs of orphans, and of those under guardianship. Fifth, he may execute a will according to the wish of the testator and the provisions of law on it, without causing any obstruction. If someone was appointed by will to administer the succession, he shall be the custodian of the inheritance. Otherwise, the judge shall appoint another. Sixth, he may appoint a deputy who is fit to be a judge. If he himself is kept too busy attending to many matters, the deputy may not delegate his power to someone without the authorization of the judge. After the death of the judge, who is fit for the office of judge, the deputy judge has no power to appoint another if the former held an important position. Only the one vested with authority may appoint his replacement. Seventh, he must know the witnesses well. He must know that those who testify as witnesses are pure, and also must know those who are trusted. Those who are trusted, the good ones among his subordinates and his chosen deputy, in order to keep them with him continuously and with confidence, and to replace them if they display laziness or incompetence. If he was appointed over a specific matter to the exclusion of other matters, his jurisdiction is limited to that matter, such as one, for instance, who is appointed over matters regarding marriage of women and not matters pertaining to property, or one who is appointed over a certain locality to the exclusion of its neighbors, or over a certain group of people to the exclusion of others because he knows the language and character of one group and not those of the others. He must not exceed his power. Rather, he shall limit himself to the administration entrusted to him. Section 3. Provisions regarding the judge. Our Lord has said in the Holy Gospel, "Judge not with partiality, but judge righteous judgment." The judge must be fair and must abide by the Lord's will. And behold, what is written in the Psalm, "Judge justly, Son of Man." And the Lord has also said, "Thou shalt not be partial towards rich in judgment, nor shalt thou favor a poor man, since in judgment there is no mercy." You must know the judgment for each sin, so that you may not do injustice upon anyone, and so that the anger of God may not arise upon you for the unjust judgment delivered from you. Remember that he will ask you for an account of your deeds, and be careful not to imitate the elder priests who were witnesses against Susanna in Babylon and condemned her to death unjustly, lest you receive the same punishment by the judges. God saved Susanna from the hands of the transgressors of the law through the prophet Daniel, and killed the elder priests, throwing them into the fire because they sinned against her. God knows the judgments you deliver. You cannot hide yourself from him. If your judgment is right, you will be rewarded for your uprightness in this world and in the one to come. But if your judgments be unjust, you will suffer many evils. And you must know the accepting bribes leads to fear of others, and then you will be like them. Do not accept any present when you appoint someone to be judge, except from one who has no power, like your son or your parents. A judge must pass to his replacement the power he had. His replacement must command his subordinates and administrators to fear God and to do eager and searching for the property of those who have suffered robbery. He must order his assistants to be merciful in settling disputes. No market, business, trading partnership, or similar enterprise shall be set up before his court. neither for his benefit nor for the benefit of the deputy judge appointed by him. He shall not receive the litigants individually in the absence of their adversaries, nor must he see them individually after they are separated. Section 4. On how he discharges his functions. He must first show the document authorizing his appointment. It shall be read to the public in the court where he carries out his duties, so that his appointment may be known. The cases of those who are in prison and those who are excommunicated shall be reported to him. He shall set free the one who, in his opinion, must be set free, and shall keep in prison those who, in his judgment, must not be released, and those who, on the strength of their own confessions or witnesses' testimony, must not be set free. If someone says, "I have suffered an injustice," and his creditor is not present to renew the lawsuit, the judge shall write a letter, so that he may appear in court for the lawsuit if he lives nearby. If he does not appear promptly, the judge shall release the debtor once the latter produces a guarantor of debt. From the one who is evidently poor, the judge shall accept the guarantee of debt and set him free, so as to give him the opportunity of finding the means to pay his debt. He shall order his subordinates not to introduce before him one adversary in the absence of the other. He also shall order them not to give the debtor precedence over the creditor, or the one who came later precedence over the one who arrived first. He must be calm, not proud. He must not judge while under the influence of something which agitates his mind, such as anger or fears which perturb him, grief or joy which make him forgetful, hunger and thirst which affect his adversely, sickness and evil which cause him pain, sleep and drowsiness which overcome him, or laziness and weakness which hurt him. He must not judge while he is drunk or lightheaded, or while he is disgusted and annoyed because of the strain of overwork. He must not hide himself except when he is resting or doing some other necessary thing. And when the litigants come before him, he shall begin with the one who arrived first. In none of the hearings shall he give precedence to the one who came last. If there are some among the litigants who are tired from traveling or who have fallen sick, the judge must treat the litigants equally in bringing them before him, in making them sit, in receiving their complaints, in hearing them, in talking to them, and in judging them, be it for or against. He shall not talk in a whisper to one, nor give the other occasion to suspect him. He shall not quarrel with any litigant, nor shall he favor one person. Be he strong or weak, humble or important, the important one must not get the impression that the judge is afraid of him, and the poor and the humble must not lose hope of seeing justice done. Once the litigants have argued before him, he shall not delay giving his decision without a justifiable cause. He shall not judge in the cases involving himself, or if the cases involve his parents, grandparents, sons, grandsons, brothers, or his wife, but he shall judge in cases involving others. He may judge when litigants, including members of his family, agree to be ruled by him, but preferably he must refuse. But these people must bring their case before his deputy, and the judge must not testify for them. Also, he must not give a decision either for or against his enemy, neither shall he be a witness against him, because judicial decisions are public while testimony is given in secret. If a new case similar to another he had ruled upon previously comes before him, he must rule in a manner that demonstrates carefully study of the new case, even if the sentence conflicts with the previous one. But he shall not invalidate his own decision, nor the decision of another judge, unless the decision contradicts the word of the law. Unless it does not conform to the word of the law, its interpretation, the provisions of the canons which the fathers were assembled to write with knowledge acquired by God's help, or what seems correct in his opinion. And note that it is preferable to return to a right decision than to leave a wrong decision uncorrected. The judge shall decide on the basis of what is made clear in the court by a reliable word, when his understanding is made certain by the one who confesses, or by what is manifested by witnesses, if there are witnesses, or by an oath, if there is an oath. Never shall he give a decision on a case without inquiring into it further if he is ignorant of the facts. Section 5, on oath. Apostle Paul has said, "And the oath which a man takes is to swear by one greater than himself. Every controversy which happens between men is ended by an oath, and because of this, especially the Lord wanted to show to the heirs of the promise that his promise does not pass, and he confirmed it by an oath. And since there is nothing greater than himself by which he might swear, he swore by himself and said in blessing, 'I shall bless thee, and I shall multiply thee.' Though our Lord said in the gospel, 'You shall not swear at all,' he did not say, 'Do not swear in lawsuits,' because all he said with respect to the proper way of speaking is, 'Let your speech be yes, yes, or no, no.' And added, 'And that which is added over and above this comes of evil.' The extra talk is unnecessary, while taking an oath during a lawsuit is essential. But it is proper that a man avoid taking an oath if he can, either by paying his money or without paying anything, for the glory of God and for the hope of what is near him. Explaining the word, St. John Chrysostom has said, 'If you say, what is this oath, which every one of us expects from the other and gives to his companion when he demands it, I say that it must be given with the fear of God. And he who follows the precepts of the Christian faith does not demand an oath, as he is feared by others, and God helps him. Do not swear in the name of God for trifles, especially do not swear falsely. God has commanded us not to swear in any manner other than that laid down in the holy books. But if we cannot avoid taking an oath, we shall swear to make up for the deficiency in man's knowledge. In this case, we shall swear with the fear of God, lest we be judged with a terrifying oath. And if one of the clergy swears falsely in the name of God, he shall be expelled for 3 years. If two persons enter a contract for a business or for a partnership, or make a pact and draw up a document confirming their oaths not to go back upon their word, and then one of them fails to observe what was written, the judge shall punish him for taking a false oath and shall compel him to observe what was written. If one who is ordered to take an oath has sworn by putting his hand on the gospel, and his lie is then discovered, he shall be punished. Know that in the previous law of the Old Testament, the divine law demands the doing of good deeds through making justice known, and then in the latter law of the New Testament, it demands that one perseveres in doing good and hidden deeds. The ancient law forbade swearing falsely and provided for the punishment of one who swore falsely. But in the new law, an oath according to the law of reason should not be uttered, pursuant to what our Lord said in the gospel. It was said to you, to yours of old, 'You shall not forswear yourselves, but I say to you, not to swear at all.' An oath, be it out of necessity or without necessity, is taken with knowledge or on the basis of one's opinion. The first oath taken out of necessity and with knowledge is permitted. The second oath is uncertain because it occurs in the words tending towards mistake or forgetfulness, and this is because of a bad habit, such as falling into error in other things with knowledge or lack of knowledge, or especially because one acts involuntarily without reflecting. In any of these cases, the one who swore must repent regardless whether he swore truly or falsely. As to the first oath, if it is in reference to the past, the oath must run, 'I swear on God that I did not do,' or 'I did,' or 'You have nothing on yours with me,' or 'You owe me.' If the oath is with reference to the future, it must run, 'God knows I shall not do,' or 'I shall do.' The oath concerning the past is divided into three. First, if it is given with sure knowledge whereby the thoughts tallies with the spoken word. In this case, the matter may be settled peacefully, avoiding swearing if it is possible. If it is not possible, the fault is upon the one who makes the other swear, although the latter is not a debtor, if he is aware of his injustice. But if the mind of the one who swears is uncertain whether he owes something or not, and he wants to swear notwithstanding that, he must return to the truth and ask God for forgiveness. But if his oath is in accordance with the truth, he commits no sin at all unless his conscience is uncertain. Second, If he swore to something while aware that he was lying, this means that the spoken word contradicts the thought. One must abstain from this because the word of God is the Mosaic law. In the Mosaic law says, "Thou shalt not swear falsely in the name of God, thy Creator." And if one swears falsely by the temptation of the devil, he must return to the truth and thus to penance. Third, if an oath involves a mistake, it must be avoided by reaching a peaceful settlement in the best way possible, as said earlier. If this cannot be done, the one who compels the other to swear is to be blamed so long as he knows his injustice or is doubtful. There is no doubt that an oath on something which is to take place in the future must be fulfilled, provided that the oath concerns good things and does not lead to the commission of a sin. But if it entails a sin, one must draw back from it. One must not keep an oath regarding something that will occur in the future, if it is about a prohibited thing, but one must honor it if it is about a lawful thing. He who swears to a prohibited thing must do penance, lest he add sin to his action by his action to the sin committed by the spoken word. Know that the proper way of taking an oath is to swear in the name of God, and that there is no difference between these two names, that is, between the name of God and the name of Christ, since both names belong to God. The name of Christ is the name of God who became man, and he who wishes to say something to impress and frighten others using some of his names mentioned in the divine books may do so. One may say, for instance, God, great, strong, powerful, one who knows hidden as well as apparent things, one who rewards everybody according to one's deeds, one who does not forgive one who swears in his name falsely. One may not swear by something other than God, his attributes, or something belonging to him. Among the things that belong to him are his gospel, his cross, his altar, and his saints. A person who has lost his reason or has not attained majority shall not be made to take an oath. This raises a question. Swearing in the name of God is equivalent to swearing in the name of Christ. But it is not true in the reverse, because the name of God, may he be praised, encompasses the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, while the name of Christ refers to the Son only. Section 6, the tribunal, those who go there, and those who do not. Priests and deacons shall be with you, O bishops, in the court of judgment, and as men of God, you shall judge without partiality and with justice. Remember that Christ, the Son of God, is present among you in court to observe your judgments and to hear you speak. And God has said in the law, neither shalt thou join the multitude to do evil, nor shalt thou accept the worthless talk, nor sit in the gathering of those who despise justice. A pure and clean seat where cold and heat will not touch them, and which does not smell, shall be prepared for the judges. They shall not sit in the church or in the sanctuary to administer justice, because only priests are allowed to enter the sanctuary. No quarrels or cries must take place in the tribunal. Experienced persons must sit with the judge, and the assistant judges must be present, so that when difficult questions arise, the judge may consult them on those questions. And if he is not certain what sentence to deliver, he shall postpone the case until he becomes certain. Section 7. The time and manner of judgment. Judges shall not deliver any decision on Sundays, and the creditor, the judge, the soldiers, and the tax collector shall not frighten the people on that day. You shall assemble to settle judicial matters on Monday. If there is a lawsuit, you shall settle it and be reconciled during this week by Saturday, so that the lawsuit may be settled, and you will already have reconciled the litigants by the holy day of Sunday. And as provided by the law, when the litigants come to you, both shall stand before you at the center of the court. After you hear what they say, you shall judge between them with justice and uprightness. You shall not judge solely on the basis of what one of them says before his adversary appears, but when both litigants are present, you shall judge between them with justice. The Lord has said, look for justice and judge according to it. When you sit down to judge and the litigants argue before you face to face, you shall not call them brothers until they are reconciled, and you shall release them from their debts only if they deserve it. And we have already said that it is not right that you decide against one before both appear together, because if you give your decision in haste on the basis of what only one of them said when the other party was not present to defend himself, you will deserve the sentence you passed. You will be an accomplice in the lie and suffer its consequences before the Almighty. A man cannot be represented by his slave in bringing a lawsuit before the judge, since a slave is not equal in honor to a free man. Know that it is the accuser who must produce witnesses to prove something, and the accused who must take an oath. If they agree to let the accuser take an oath, it may be done, and then the debt is binding on the one who denied it. Ordinarily, the accuser is the one who asked for payment and therefore should produce witnesses, while the accused is the one who is asked to pay and therefore takes an oath. An accusation brought by someone who is not the owner of the object which is the cause of the accusation is of no effect. Similarly, the accused must have in his possession the object for which he is accused. When both parties come before the judge, he shall say to them, "Speak out." He shall keep silent until they speak, and if both appear as accusers, the one who brought the charge first shall have priority, and when he has finished with his charge, the charge brought by the other shall be heard. If one insults the other or says shameful words, the judge shall cut him short. If he does this again, the judge shall reproach him, and if he persists in this, the judge shall excommunicate him. And if the judge cannot understand the charge brought by one of them, he shall say to him, "Make the charge you brought clear." He shall not give his decision until the accuser describes the object and indicates its quality and quantity in unequivocal language, for instance, by saying, "I gave him 50 Egyptian dinars." The word Egyptian dinars describes the quality 50. If the accuser brings a clear charge which is understandable, the judge shall say to the other, "What say you?" If the accused admits the charge, the judge shall say to the accuser, "Here, he admits, he is your debtor." If the accuser claims his property, the judge shall decide in his favor and against the debtor. But if the accused denies the charge, the judge shall say to the accuser, "Have you witnesses?" If the accuser says no, he shall say in his turn to the accused, "Will you swear?" If the accused is afraid to swear and turns back the oath to his accuser, and if then the accuser takes the oath, the object shall be restored to him. But if the accused, after he shows his fear of taking the oath, says, "I swear," one shall not hear him except with the consent of the other. But if he then goes to another court and does not refuse to take the oath, he shall not be prevented from taking the oath. If the accuser says, "I have reliable witnesses," and demands an oath from his adversary, the latter shall not be obliged to swear before the accuser produces the witnesses. And if the accuser says, "I have reliable witnesses," and one of the witnesses testifies after having refused, he must be heard. If the witnesses produced by the accuser are not enough, the judge shall require him to produce some more witnesses in order to be more certain. If they are upright and have the fear of God, he must keep them separate and interrogate them one at a time about the truthfulness of their testimony and the place, as Daniel did with the two elders who testified against Susanna. If their testimony is identical, he shall warn each of them separately by frightening them and striking terror in them about the passing things, about those things which do not pass, about the time of life, thus reminding them of the divine punishments that have befallen those who were false witnesses since antiquity. He shall tell them that from the spiritual point of view, it is better to come back to the righteous way than to dare to vain things, since to repent is better than doing vain things, while to persist in doing them is to commit sins upon sins. If after this they persevere in being witnesses, and the fear of God is in them, the judge shall say to the accused, "Here A and B have testified against you. You have accepted their testifying, but I give you permission to rebuke their testimony." The judge says this in order to judge between them by ascertaining the reliability of the witnesses. If in a subsequent examination all the witnesses testify in contradiction to their previous testimony, or if only one of them persists in his previous testimony, the previous testimony condemning the accused shall be disregarded, since only one of the witnesses persists. If the accused keeps silence, neither admitting nor denying the charge, the judge, to get an answer from him, shall say to him again, "Answer, otherwise you must take an oath, or produce a guarantor for the object you are accused of having." If the accused says, "I have witnesses to say that I have nothing of what he accuses me of having," he shall be given time to bring the evidence, and the accuser shall not disturb him until he produces the witnesses. If he delays past the time given to produce the witnesses, he must either take an oath or confess. If there is much talk among the witnesses, one shall judge on the basis of the predominant testimony. If the word of one of them has no more weight than that of the other, one shall decide in their presence as he would have decided if they were not produced. The word of the one who is in possession of the object, supported by his oath, shall be accepted if his adversary does not produce witnesses who testify that the other has committed perjury. If someone dares to accuse a woman who is inexperienced in litigation and does not travel for buying and trading, the woman shall not be compelled to come to court. She shall give an order appointing someone to represent her. If she has to take an oath, the judge shall send a righteous man to her to take her oath. The judge shall write a special and separate book about his judgments for submission to another superior judge. This book shall bear the testimony of two or more witnesses who testify in favor of the judge's decision, and this superior judge shall examine the correctness of the judge's decisions. If he has accepted the witness's testimony, he shall decide on the basis of those decisions. The conclusion of Section 7 concerns some matters which are dealt with in their respective chapters, such as charitable legacies, manumissions, deposit, free loan, sale and purchase, lease, succession, wills, and similar things. Section 8, on peaceful settlements. A peaceful settlement is commanded by the word of our Lord in the Gospel. Go first and reconcile thyself to thy brother. Then coming back, thou shalt offer thy gift, and also his saying, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God." The apostle have also said that the servants of Christ must not be enemies of each other. The one of you should support the other. Be careful to keep spiritual love in the bond of peace. Let not the sun go down upon your anger. Give not way to the devil for seducing you. Try to make peace between those who quarrel before the judgment of the bishop is delivered. Litigation achieves no good in this world for the trouble which one causes to another due to anything of this world is a deed of the devil and of his temptations, and a man should hasten to defeat his temptations, even if he loses some of his belongings. It is better that you lose something of yours and be eager to be all men's brothers, and not only with your brothers, but with all people. Because if you lose something in this world, you shall not lose anything of God, since you are a minister of God, one who lives according to the precepts of Christ. You shall bring those who quarrel to mutual love, because our Lord has said, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God." But those who create enmity, war, and quarrels, and those who bring lawsuits are unjust and strangers to God, since the Lord is a God of mercy. Now you already have condemned your body when you became enemies and when you quarreled one with the other. And why do you not rather suffer wrong? And why do you not rather suffer injustice? But you do wrong and defraud your brothers. Do you not know that the unjust shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Know that a peaceful settlement regarding a determinate object may be made by compensating the giving something to avoid the necessity of taking an oath, thus ending enmity and the lawsuit for the sake of God's will and out of regard for men. Peaceful settlement is divided into three, namely, peace by admission, peace by denial, and peace by keeping silent, which occurs when one does not admit or deny the accusation. If a claim for an object is to be settled by giving the claimant another object, the dispute is settled when an object is given for the claimed object. They shall be done as people do in selling and purchasing. If the settlement concerns an object that was hired to yield profit, it shall be in accordance with the contract of hire they made. Every kind of settlement is allowed provided that there is no usury in it. As, for instance, when the settlement is made upon an amount of 20 in ready money or 30 at a future time, or when instead of a measure of old grain due now, nearly harvested grain is to be given in the future. This is certainly allowed. A settlement shall be void if the terms agreed upon are not observed. For instance, if the settlement was to be made upon payment within a fixed time, and the debtor did not pay within that time, or if it was to be made on condition that the debtor give the creditor a part of some object, and the former refused to give back even that much, a settlement to be made of a debt by paying something other than the kind of object owed before the time payment of the debt is tantamount to selling the debt. A settlement to be made of a debt by paying another object equivalent to the object owed at the proper time extinguishes the debt. Section 9 providing that Christians shall not bring suit at the court of infidels, that judges shall be appointed from among archpriests or priests, that no one shall judge in a case involving himself, and that no one shall refuse to appear before the judge when a lawsuit is brought against him. Apostle Paul has said, if there is someone who has a quarrel with his companion, they shall accuse each other before the saints, not before the slanderers and unjust, but before the saints and the pure. Do you not know that the pure shall judge this world? And if the world shall be judged by you, are you not worthy to judge this small judgment? Do you not know that we shall judge the angels, and how much more that which is in this world? But if between you and another man of this world there is a quarrel, set among you those who are in the least degree in the church to judge between you. And I have said this to your shame. So then, is there not among you a wise man, not even one who is able to judge between brothers, so much that the brother becomes the enemy to the brother or goes to sue him before those who are unbelievers? A Christian shall not go to a pagan magistrate nor to a magistrate of heretics to be judged by him in any matter, because the devil prepares many traps for some of the servants of God through their companions. It is shameful for them that they do not have even one wise man among them capable of judging among them, one who knows the judgment each deserves and saves the one from the other in order to remove quarrels. And so do not let the pagans know anything of the disputes that occur among you. Any case that involves priests shall be brought for judging, not before a lay judge, but before the bishop and the archpriest. Lay judges cannot sit in judgment over the church. Rather, it is the church that sits in judgment on every man. If someone has a quarrel with another and does not go before a judge, but rather acts by his own will, as if he had authority, using force to take what his debtor owes him, this man shall not be given anything. And if he takes what does not belong to him, he shall be brought before the judge in the place where he lives, so that he may be punished. If he does not appear before the magistrate to be judged, but puts himself in the place of the judge who vindicates, taking his object without an order of the judge, he shall be deprived of what he took. If someone takes anything from the hands of others without an order of the judge, and the thing was his own, he shall lose his ownership of it. If the thing belonged to the one from whom he took it, he shall return together with the price it fetches, and something additional to this. If someone is accused before a judge and refuses to go, and if trustworthy people testify against him, he shall be punished or excommunicated until he goes to the court for the lawsuit. Section 10, provisions on the continuation of the judge in his office. This section serves to establish the conditions limiting the duration of the judge's office, to define the acts of judging proper to his rank, to clarify what is found in the document authorizing his appointment and writing of the precepts given to him at his appointment, and the limit of his competence in judgment, and to set out whatever is left from what has been said in this chapter. Know that whatever did not obstruct one from being appointed a judge cannot prevent him from continuing to occupy that office. Since he should be full of health when appointed, there must be a total deficiency of health found in him to dismiss him from his office. For instance, if he falls unconscious, one shall wait if there is hope that he will be cured. If there is no hope of his cure, but he falls unconscious only occasionally, they shall be patient with him, but not otherwise. Section 11. On dismissal of a judge from his office. A judge may not resign without the consent of the one who appointed him. The latter may not dismiss the former without manifest cause. If a judge is dismissed or resigns himself, this must be made public, just as his appointment was, so that the lawsuits before him may be interrupted. As for a decision given by the judge after his dismissal, if it was given after he was notified of his dismissal, it is void. But if it was given before he learned of his dismissal, the decision is valid. The deputy judge appointed by him to administer justice under him shall not be dismissed until his replacement dismisses them for a manifest cause. And if after his dismissal he says, "I had decided thus on such a matter," it is not sufficient unless there are witnesses who testify together with him. But this proceeding can happen only if one of the litigants is not satisfied with the decision, or if the judge was not promoted to a higher rank, like a priest who upon dismissal from the office of judge is promoted to the rank of bishop or patriarch. Section 12 of witnesses. It is divided into 10 parts. First, on the necessity of appointing them. This is demonstrated by the Holy Scriptures and by reason. In the Holy Scriptures, the Lord says, every question must be settled by the voice of two or three witnesses. Also, Paul has said, do not accept the accusation against a priest unless there are two or three witnesses. You, O bishop, do not judge anyone without witnesses. And what is said in other sections shows the necessity of appointing them, since to be a man composed of the four elements is not sufficient to be a witness, but only the men who by their nature are wise and just are worthy of being witnesses. The reason is this. As some men are honest witnesses and others are dishonest, it is necessary to produce the honest ones as witnesses when a suit comes before the judge. Those whose word is reliable at the time of the proceeding must be produced in order to know the truth and to discard vain talk. And as reason tells us that it is essential to have witnesses and together in the court for matters concerning lawsuit, it is necessary to produce witnesses during the proceedings, as provided by the divine laws and others, since the witnesses confirm the truth. To receive an oath, especially if there are no witnesses, may be sufficient. Second, conditions that must be met by the witnesses. John Chrysostom has said in his explanation of the Gospel according to Matthew, this term, uprightness, is not enough. If the uprightness is observed in connection with one of the virtues only, namely justice, but it is enough in the case of one who is bestowed with every virtue, since the evangelist said, they were both just in God's sight, and then said, more precisely, thereby praising them, following all the commandments and the justice of God without reproach. The apostles in turn have said, those who bear witness must be pure before God, not irascible, but trusted, saints, lovers of neighbors, and merciful, not wicked or avid, but peaceful and good. Such are the persons whose testimony is acceptable because of their good conduct, their true word, and their good deeds. The testimony of those whose behavior is other than this shall not be accepted, even if their words are the same. All those who testify as witnesses must be among those in whom one has confidence, neither poor in intelligence nor completely mad. What is required from witnesses is that they be of high status and faith and have praiseworthy habit of good deeds. And note that according to the wise, uprightness belongs to the one whose rational soul has been perfected by learning and doctrines of the virtues, and by noble actions, who has mastered the forces of anger and concupiscence. who uses them for spiritual works, and who suppresses by means of one of them the craving of the others, which always seek corporal satisfactions. And note that what is expected from those who are witnesses is the true word. Since this may not be given without knowledge of the matter, mortification, virtue, and abstention from contemptible things, it becomes necessary to prohibit one whose veracity is not perfect from being a witness. Only one who is completely truthful may testify. Third, matters that justly disqualify. Let none bear witness but the faithful. Anyone who is below 20 years of age is under guardianship. If deaf, dumb, a buffoon, or one who dissipates his property, is poor, or a slave, is condemned as fornicator, or is under another's authority, and may be punished, such as a soldier of a chief. None of those who fall within these categories and place themselves outside the law shall testify as witnesses. To these must be added, in order to prevent him from testifying, the ones whose sin is known. For instance, he who keeps a concubine or drinks, he who habitually commits little as well as big sins, he who plays the games of El Hazala, El Makamer, droughts, or chess on the street, he who eats in the market, and he who disguises himself by an appearance not his own, such as a priest who tattoos himself or dresses as a soldier. Gloss: the word poor means the poor man who asks for alms, and not those who, by their own choice, forsake worldly wealth in order to obtain the riches which will come. Fourth, on the number of witnesses. The number of witnesses must be at least two or three, since every question must be settled on the word of two or three witnesses as commanded by God in both testaments, namely the Mosaic Law and the Gospel. For greater certainty, the number may be increased. The testimony of one witness only shall never be accepted. They must be three, not any less, and must prove that they have done good deeds since their childhood. Do not be satisfied with false testimony. The witnesses during the making of a contract of loan must be five, and those who are witnesses to the drawing up of a will shall be seven or five in number. Fifth, on fixing the time for giving testimony, for making the report of testimony, and for producing witnesses. The number of days that a witness will take to travel the distance to court at a normal rate, the day set for giving evidence, and the day set for reporting the testimony shall be communicated to the one who desired to produce the witnesses, so that he may provide what they require for their food. Sixth, on those whose testimony is not valid, be it for or against. A man cannot testify on his own behalf with his own words only. As our Lord Jesus Christus has said, may he be praised, said, if I testify in my own behalf, that testimony of mine is worth nothing. And of being pure, he said, you judge yourself just, but God knows your hearts. No one shall testify for his kinsman. It is obvious that a man must not testify for his son, the son of his son, his descendants, his father, his mother, his grandfather, his ascendants, his wife, his sister, his brother, his slave, his partner, in matters concerning their partnership, or the one he has named in his will. That is, he must not testify for them unless the one against whom he testifies gives consent, or unless he is equally related to the one for whom he testifies and the other, as in the case of two sons and two grandfathers. In these cases, their testimony is valid against those we have mentioned, whether the witness is one of the above named persons or another. Never shall one testify regarding the writing of a will if he is the heir at law. If his name is mentioned there as heir, or if he was appointed administrator of the estate by the testator, nor is the testimony of a slave given in support of the master who manumitted him, nor for his former masters acceptable. No man shall give testimony against his enemy or against his debtor, unless they had previously consented to his testimony either for or against him. One who made peace between men shall not testify regarding that matter, regardless of the matter in question. If a man previously testified against another concerning some fault, the latter cannot testify against the former. He who incites a quarrel regarding any matter and then reconciles it cannot testify regarding it. Any person whose testimony is valid is competent to testify on his own behalf. His testimony offered for himself is valid. Never shall the testimony of heretics against a bishop be accepted. Neither shall the testimony of only one bishop be accepted against him. One who attested an invalid will may not testify until the testator renders it valid. The laws does not compel him to testify. Note that this shows that testimony is like a deposit entrusted to the witnesses who give testimony to the benefit of the depositor. It is necessary that they give it to him when he demands it, so that it may be useful to him. One who does not give it to him deprives him of his wealth, and one shall not require remuneration for it, neither for having kept it with him, nor for having taken it from him. 7. On unreliable testimony. The testimony given by persons who were passing by or the like is not valid in any respect. Such a case is when one says, I was working near A, and I heard another person say that he had taken from B, such as such and such a thing. Since this testimony is not given from direct knowledge, it does not deserve to be accepted. Never shall testimony given under duress be valid until the witnesses are identified, the matter inquired into, and the facts ascertained. 8. On avoiding false testimony, and on the debt owed by a false witness who persists in his false testimony, should his testimony be impeached by true testimony. God has said, Thou shalt not bear false witness. If someone bears witness against another, so that the latter will be disposed from his rank or punished, and it is later discovered that the witness testified falsely, he shall be condemned to a punishment the same as that to which the person against whom he testified falsely was condemned. 9. On matters which bar a person from testifying, which are an abandonment of the proper precepts and an adherence to things which bar giving testimony. Never shall a person who was charged with accepting money to bear false testimony be competent to testify. And it is necessary that a witness mindful of that to which he testifies. If he withdraws from his testimony, it must be because of an obvious cause. 10th, on testimony regarding other testimony. One cannot be a witness regarding testimony given by another, except in the case where the first witness says to the second witness, Be it witness to my testimony, which is as follows. If the second has seen it, has borne witness before the judge regarding the testimony of the former, and has confirmed it, his testimony is valid. Even if the former objects, the second shall be a witness. Testimony regarding other testimony is also valid if the first witness is sick, in prison, on a journey, or dead. But if these circumstances are not present, if something which excludes the second witness from testifying happens, if he quarrels with the person against whom he is testifying, or especially if there is a cause which bars him from testifying in that particular matter, he is not a trustworthy witness. In the case of testimony regarding another testimony, if two or three witnesses give their testimony, they shall be counted in the number of witnesses. Section 13, Provisions Regarding Witnesses. There are eight parts. First, on testimony regarding crimes. One must not believe the testimony given by every man, because there are many people who accuse their brother falsely, out of envy or malice, as did the two elders who bore witness against Susanna in Babylon. You, O bishop, must be careful in these matters. As a man of God, do not punish someone on the basis of the testimony of such persons. Do not ruin one who has not sinned. Do not cause the death of one who is just. Second, on the coming of the witnesses to testify. Those who bear witness to a document of debt or the loan must declare that they were present when the money was received by the borrower, and that the admission of that same borrower that he was a debtor took place in their presence, as provided in the law. They must declare also that they were called solely to attest this matter. At the time of difficulty and of fraud, the witnesses must come in person and not merely send the words of their testimony. One considers the testimony of those who are witnesses and not merely their presence, because the testimony of the man given by himself removes from him any suspicion of falsehood. Third, on the disagreement of witnesses. When the testimony of the witnesses is in disagreement, or one witness quarrels with another, or their testimony is false, the judge must accept the testimony of those whose words is reliable, and flog the liars if it is known that they are accustomed to doing evil. And if most of the witnesses say one thing, and there are some who differ from them, he shall not listen to the greater number, but to those who agree. Those who among the witnesses have no hate or love towards the accused, and in whom the judge and those who are present with him have confidence, for one shall not believe witnesses merely because they are numerous, but rather because they are loyal and truthful. The judge must examine each witness whether he is honorable and without stain, or despicable and of bad reputation, whether he is wealthy or poor, whether he is one who may be suspected of some transgression for the sake of gain. The judge must also examine whether the witnesses is a friend of the one of the suitors or an enemy of the other. If his behavior is free of any stain, then his testimony is reliable, and the judge must notice whether the witnesses all declare the same thing, whether they reply to what is asked of them in a satisfactory way, and the reason why particular testimony must not be accepted. Fourth, about those who are chosen to testify and those who choose them. Those among the witnesses who have the knowledge of a child shall be examined to see if they are fit to bear witness when their testimony is required, and if the testimony of a foreigner is required, his testimony shall not be accepted unless he is carefully examined. Do not consider to be pure the one who is not pure, for here is written a saying, "Woe to him who discharges as pure the one who is wicked, by reason of accepting bribes, and who denies true judgment to the poor man, preventing him from getting what is due to him." Fifth, if someone twice produces witnesses from among his enemies, and at the second hearing they testify against him, he cannot free himself from this testimony and seek to show that they are his enemies or some other similar disqualification, unless in the interval between the two hearings an obvious enmity had arisen between him and them, rendering the witnesses disqualified, or unless he produces clear testimony to show that their words are false. Sixth, one who produces witnesses three times and does not produce others must produce four other witnesses once the falsehood of the former witnesses has been proved to the judge before he may make any statement. Seventh, the accuser must prove by questioning his adversary that the object is his, that it was not taken justly, and that it belongs not to his adversary, but to others. However, the property shall not change hands until the decision is made, the decision the judge has given. No one shall produce witnesses to prove that the object which is the cause of the charge against him belongs to him. Eighth, on withdrawing testimony. If the witnesses withdraw their testimony before the judge and during the proceeding is rendered void. But if they withdraw it after the proceeding has ended, the judgment shall not be annulled. Rather, all the witnesses shall share the death equally. They shall be liable for the damage caused by their false testimony, and if one of them withdraws, he shall bear half the debt, if the witnesses are three or more, and more than two withdraw their testimony during the hearing, they shall not be liable for anything. Nothing is lost from the property by their withdrawal, as they have withdrawn their testimony. If after the proceeding, two or more witnesses withdraw their testimony and only one remains, those who withdraw shall bear as a debt half of the property, because that is the amount which they caused to perish. Chapter 44. Kings. It is in five sections. Section 1. The king you appoint must be one of your brethren. It is not proper for you to appoint over yourself an alien and an infidel, lest he multiply horses, women, gold, and silver to himself. And when he sits on the throne of his kingdom, some priest shall write for him the divine book, so that he may keep it by his side and read it throughout his life, in order to learn the fear of God, his creator, to observe his commandments and to practice them, lest his heart become proud and feel contempt for his brethren. He must never swerve either to the right or to the left from what has been laid down in the law, so that his days and his son's days may be prolonged in his kingdom, and his faith in God may be perfect. Because of faith, the walls of Jericho were pulled down when the sons of Israel marched around them for 7 days. Because of faith, Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah and David defeated the kings, served the cause of justice, found what they hoped for, were victors in war, and defeated the army of the enemy. And if the king becomes a heretic, from that moment he is no longer a king, but a rebel. Section 2. Our Lord said in the Gospel, "Give to the king what is the king's, and to God what is God's." And Apostle Paul said in his letter to the Romans, "Every one of you must be submissive to the authority of your ruler, since a ruler is appointed only by God, and God has appointed all these rulers and given them authority. One who opposes the rulers and rebels against them rebels against the ordinance of God, his creator. Those who rebel against the rulers secure their condemnation. Judges and rulers are not terrifying to those who do good, but to those who do wrong. If thou, O man, would be free from fear of rulers, do right, and thou shalt win his approval, since he is God's minister and servant, calling thee to good and beautiful things. But if thou doest wrong, fear the ruler, and beware of him, since it is not for nothing that he puts on the sword. He is God's minister, and with anger he takes revenge on wrongdoers. Therefore, we must be submissive to him, not only for fear of his anger, but also in your conscience. It is for the same reason that we give tribute, since one who is appointed to keep public affairs orderly is God's minister, and one who does his will. Give every man his due, tribute if it be tribute, fear if it be fear, honor if it be honor, tithes if it be tithes." St. John Chrysostom, in his explanation of this passage, has said, "The apostle had already shown this in his other letters, commanding the lesser chiefs to give due obedience to the higher chiefs, as the servant must obey the master." This, the apostle did, showing that our Lord did not abrogate all the laws by his precepts, but confirmed them. And his saying, "Every soul is because every man must conform himself to this," and his saying, "A ruler is appointed only by God," means that God has provided for the appointment of judges and rulers to take place, so that the world may become beautifully calm. And for that reason, he has established the ruler, since equality of forces causes many wars, and God, in his wisdom, has established many kinds of authority, such as that of man in respect to woman, the father in respect to the son, the old in respect to the young, the master in respect to the slave, the teacher in respect to the disciple, and more so the chief in respect to the one who is placed under him. The Lord acted in the same manner with the body, creating the head and placing the other parts under it. He also did thus with animals, such as bees, raza, ants, antelopes, eagles, buffaloes, and all kinds of fish. Every one has its chief, and when there is no authority, there is confusion and lack of order. And his words, since he is God's minister calling thee to good and beautiful things, mean that he will lead you daily in your obedience to God. His punishments will be directed against those who rebel against God, murderers, fornicators, thieves, and wrongdoers. But his favors goes to the obedient who obey the highest, whose name be praised, to those who despise the world, and to those who do works of perfection and are righteous. For the spiritual and corporal benefits which we derive from the ruler, let us give him tribute and presents in payment for them. The tribute is meant to provide the judges with the necessities which they are in need of, since they put aside their own interest and care for the public welfare. Do not say that A has transgressed the law, but consider the order obtained by the law. There is no peace if an authority is not constituted. Instead, because of the lack of authority, there is great confusion and lack of peace, which leads to the loss of life and existence. Indeed, you must see the wisdom of the legislator who arranged all things, being first in his unity. And if you say that you are better than your ruler by faith and by works, know that this is not your time to have a higher position than his, since now you are a pilgrim and feeble. Your time will come. It is not yet known that you are better than he, and this living place is not a place for compensation. Section 3. Let the king give honor to the order of the clergy as Constantine elected faithful and righteous king, and those who were after him did. Let him give from his wealth to each of them, according to their rank. First of all, he shall give to the bishops, then to the priests, next to the deacons, and then to those who are below them. He shall exempt them from tribute, presents, and the other things to be given to the rulers. Let him assign something to the churches for the maintenance of widows, orphans, and the poor, so that they may entreat God to strengthen the true faith with belief in the Holy Trinity, so that the day of the Christians' kings may be long. And let the king assign to God a part of the presents and of the spoils of war, as King David and other righteous kings did. Let him not raise his hand against priests or God's saints, so that what befell the evil kings of Israel and others may not befall him. When you have reached the land which God will give you, and have settled there, you shall set apart the first fruits of the land, and carry them to the place that God hath chosen, to the priest who has the office at that time. Give worship to the Lord thy God, and feast on all good things the Lord thy God has given to thee, thou, thy home, the priest, and the stranger that is in thy home. Section 4. The king shall judge with equity in the middle of his people. He shall not be partial either towards himself or towards the others, towards his son, his relatives, his friends, or the alien in any way which brings about injustice. And it is written in reference to kings, the honored king loves justice, but the unjust king loves evil and injustice to the ruin of his soul. And Solomon the wise has said, to increase justice and save the oppressed is better than the offering of sacrifices. Do not take the wealth of anyone by violence. Do not bury from him by force. Do not buy from him by force, either openly or by trick, in order not to be afflicted by God in his world and in the future. In this world, as befell the king Ahab and his wife Jezebel, when Naboth refused to sell him his vineyard, and Jezebel schemed to kill him and took the vineyard, God smote Ahab and made his race perish. And next to him, he smote Jezebel, and the dogs ate her in the aforesaid vineyard. As for the future world, the apostle said, wrongdoers and apostates shall not inherit God's kingdom. Never shall the king wrong orphans and widows, since the highest Lord has said, if you wrong them, and they cry out to me, their cry will be heard by me, and I will answer them. My anger will blaze against you. I will smite you with war. Your wives will be widows and your children orphans. The king shall rule his friends and soldiers with leniency, and with clemency. He shall act according to the advice of the old and of the judges. Neither shall he hear against them the advice of the young who have grown up with him, nor shall he make his governing heavy upon them, taking heed of what was done to Solomon's son by his father's friends. He shall treat well the sons of the kings who ruled before him, as David did the descendant of Saul. He shall also treat well the ministers of the preceding king. He shall not ill-treat them. Let what happened to the king of Ammon be a warning to the king, as God gave David victory over him when he ill-treated his ministers, and if his father is still king. He shall be careful not to rebel against him, lest God smite him, just as Absalom was defeated in war when he betrayed his father and attempted to take over the crown. When thou goest out to war with thy host against thy enemies, keep thyself clean of all offense. Should anyone be not pure, he must leave the camp. He must enter again the next day, after he purifies himself, so that thy camp may be holy, so that no impurity may be found among thee, and so that the presence of God may not be withdrawn from thee. When thou goest out to war against thy enemy, and thou seest horses, chariots, and a people more numerous than thy own, never be made afraid by them. The Lord thy God is with thee. And when thou beginnest to fight, let the priest speak first. Let him say to the people, attend, you are going into battle against your enemies. Do not let your heart be frightened. Do not fear them, for God is with you, fighting your enemies. Do not go back before their faces, because God, your Lord, goes before you. He will save you and will kill your enemy. This is a passage in the Canons of the Kings, where it is said, when Christians go out to war against their enemies, they shall put before them the cross of Christ. They shall give worship to it, and shall cry before God 100 times, saying, Kyrie eleison, and then let the herald speak and say, none must come to the battle compelled against his will. When God gives you power over them, declare your faith before them, and when you find that their faith is the true faith, then they are your brethren. Otherwise, you will make them your slaves and give tribute and serve you. When you reach a city or country to fight against its inhabitants, offer them terms of peace. If they accept you and open their gates, the men who are there shall become your subjects and shall give you tribute. But if they refuse the terms of peace and offer battle and fight against you, go forward to assault and oppress them, since the Lord your God will give them to you. But if they seek refuge among you, you shall have mercy on them, since the Lord has said, blessed are the merciful, they shall obtain mercy. And it is necessary to thank God, the giver, because he has had mercy on his servants. The disciples of Christ, when they said to our Lord, wouldst thou bid fire come down and consume them, as Elias did, our Lord held them back by saying, do you not know of what spirit you are? For by mercy and by charity towards men, man imitates his creator, and the Christian is distinguished from others. And if thou surround the city, and thou hast been a long time besieging it to fight until the gates open, do not cut its trees, since the trees of the field cannot flee before you, but cut trees which do not yield fruit, and fight against the inhabitants of the city till you conquer them. And when you pass through the city of your brethren, do not harm them, pay them with money for the food and the water you need, so that the Lord may bless you. If someone redeems a prisoner for a certain price from the one who took him, and the prisoner has some property, he shall give his redeemer the price for which he rescued him. He shall redeem himself and be freed. If he has no wealth, he shall remain in the hands of the one who redeemed him and work as a mercenary until he pays the price for his release from his wages, after an agreement on this has been made before the people. If a fugitive takes refuge with you, you shall not give him back to his master, but let him remain where he wishes among you, in one of your cities, and do not oppress him. From the spoils of war, a sixth part shall be taken for the royal private treasury. The remaining part shall be distributed equally among the judges and rulers. If there is one who has a greater share than another, The latter shall be given from the part still undivided. The custodian left to guard the army's camp shall take his share in proportion to that taken by the others. And if someone gives information treacherously to bring harm upon the kingdom so that the enemy may win, if he reveals your plans to them, flees to them, or has sold them weapons, let him be hanged and burned. Section 5. If God delivers you into the hands of your enemies because of your sins, and they take you to their country as prisoners, you must stand firm in your faith. You must be faithful to your law in food and drink, and to all the dispositions of the law, as were Daniel and the three youths, so that the Lord may save you from the lions and the fire, so that his name may be praised for your exemplary obedience, and so that he may bring you back to your country as he did those mentioned earlier. Chapter 45. Miscellaneous matters taken from the Old and New Testaments, which must be mentioned in this book, other than those mentioned in the respective chapters. Since man was created with both a soul and a body, it was necessary that two laws be laid down for him. The first serves to render perfect his external acts, those acts which are performed by the external parts of his body. The second law serves to make perfect his internal acts, those acts which are done by its conscience, his internal faculties, and his intelligence. The first law is found in the provisions of the ancient law, which is the law of justice, known as the Pentateuch. In it, visible temporal laws are laid down. They deal with temporal deeds for which a sentence passed by a judge is required, such as execution of murderers, restitution of objects stolen by thieves, beating of harm-doers, and matters other than these mentioned ones. Everything found in the law of the Pentateuch was directed at attaining this external justice and making men perfect by spiritual deeds, just as Moses and Elias were men of perfect deeds. The second spiritual law is found in the second law, which is the law of the perfection. In it, a law of reason is established for internal acts by which man corrects himself within himself, between himself and his Creator, by his own will. Such acts are refraining from anger and from looking with concupiscence, loving the enemy, forgiving one who has sinned, abstaining from eating excessively and from drunkenness, and practicing humility towards all persons. These are things which a man who wants to be perfect does voluntarily. They are not matters for which judges decide against men with compulsion. The second law does not abolish what is contained in the first law, since our Lord said, "I am not come to destroy the law, but to perfect it." Thus the duty of judges is not abolished. Wherefore it is written in the 10th chapter of the Didaskalia, "Forgive immediately the sin of your brothers." But we do not say this to judges. And it is testified in this and other books that many provisions laid down in them are taken from the Pentateuch. If then a book like this is written, it is right for what is said in the first law regarding the duty of judges in adjudging men for their external action be written in this book. Whatever is said in the second law about the correction of man by his own will is written in the respective chapters of this book. In this chapter are found those provisions which are different from those dealt with in other chapters. Before dealing with this, we must say that when the second law came, the first law was not confirmed or repealed entirely, but was divided into four parts. The first is the part left intact, as it was before, because the provisions therein, which differ from other deeds of perfection, stand valid in any age, such as worshipping the Creator and not the creatures, and abstaining from killing and fornication. The second part regards what now is completely repealed because the reason for its observance has completely ceased, and what was expected from it has been attained. Such is the case regarding the prohibition against eating pigs. Its purpose in the first law was to forbid the people of God from associating with those who did not worship God and reared pigs, and to prevent the people of God from embracing their cult and customs. Now that the faith dominates all people, with the exception of a few rebels, it is necessary to unite all believers by divine will, to abolish everything which hinders this union and those who hinder it. The third part has been perfected by adding to it other evangelical precepts, such as doing good towards friends and towards enemies. In this way, the imperfect, which was less than perfection, becomes perfect, as when one does good works on Saturdays, although it was previously commanded to cease all work. The fourth part dealt with corporal deeds, but now it has been changed to deal with spiritual deeds. These are purifying the soul with penance and the prescription related to it, instead of purifying the body with water and blood, and aspiring to the heavenly kingdom and its everlasting pleasures, instead of the earthly kingdom and its pleasure. Not all the provisions of the ancient law need be reproduced in this book. What is required is the word of the highest God, to him be praised, as found in the second book of the Pentateuch, which says, I am the Lord thy God, and thou shalt not make to thyself another God beside me. Thou shalt not make to thyself statues or images or anything that is in heaven above or in the earth beneath. Do not prostrate thyself before them, nor shalt thou adore them, since I am the Lord thy God. Thou shalt not swear falsely in the name of God thy Creator, since God will not absolve the one who swears falsely in his name. Honor thy father and thy mother, so that thou mayest find good, and thy days may be longer. Thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Thou shalt not wish for thy neighbor's house of his or his wife, his male servant or his woman servant, his beast, or anything that thy neighbor owns. These are the precepts of the law laid down for the Israelites. If someone owns a Hebrew servant, he shall own him for 6 years. In the seventh year, he shall set him free. The servant shall go out without paying any price. If he entered the service with his wife, he shall be freed with her. But if his master gave him a wife and has borne him sons and daughters, the woman and her children shall remain their master's servants, and he alone shall be set free. Should the servant say, I love my master, my wife, and my children, I do not wish freedom, he shall remain his servant forever. If a master sells his woman servant's daughter, who is the daughter of his servant, she shall not go out from his house as the female servants do. He shall not sell her to foreigners. If two men quarrel, and one of them strikes the other, or pushes him away, and he does not die, but takes to his bed, and then he rises and walks out with the help of a staff, the person which struck him shall be saved, but he shall indemnify him for the interruption of his work, and shall give to the physician his wages. If someone strikes the eye of his manservant or his womanservant and makes him blind, he shall set him free in compensation for the eye. If an ox gores a man and kills him, the ox shall be stoned and its flesh shall not be eaten. The owner of the ox shall be saved, but if the ox was wont to push with his horn yesterday and the day before, and its owner was duly warned, and this but failed to keep it in, the ox shall be stoned and its owner also shall be put to death. But if they adjudge imposing a ransom upon him, he shall pay what is asked from him for his life. If the ox kills a man servant or a woman servant, the equivalent price shall be given to his master, and the ox shall be stoned. If a man opens a pit or digs a well, does not cover it, and an ox or an ass falls into it, the owner of the well shall compensate the owner of the beast and keep the carcass. If one man's ox gores another man's ox and one of them dies, they shall sell the live ox and divide the price as well as the price of the ox that died between themselves. But if the ox was wont to gore yesterday and the day before, and its owner did not keep it in, he shall pay ox for ox, and shall take the carcass of the ox that died. If a person borrows a beast from his neighbor, and it is hurt and dies in the absence of the lender, the borrower shall compensate the owner of the thing. But if the owner of the beast was present, the borrower shall not pay him anything. If one takes a beast on hire, and it dies, the owner shall have nothing but the price of the hire. If a man seduces a virgin, not yet betrothed, and lies with her, he shall give her dowry and take her for his wife. If her father refuses to give her as wife to the seducer, the latter shall give her dowry equivalent to the dowry which is customary to give a virgin. Thou shalt not speak ill of rulers. Thou shalt not curse the ruler of thy people. Thou shalt not delay to offer the first fruits of thy harvest and of thy winepress, and shall give to me the firstborn of thy offspring. The same shalt thou do with thine oxen, thy sheep, thy asses, and their offspring. 7 days let it be with its dam, and on the eighth day thou shalt bring it to me. If thou findest thy enemy's ox or ass going astray, bring it back to him. If thou seest thy enemy's ass falling under its burden, thou shalt not pass by, but thou shalt lift it with the burden. Thou shalt not partake in the killing of a just person, and shalt not save the sinner from his deserved punishment. Nor shalt thou take bribes, since bribes blind the eyes and change the right thing. Should anyone sin and err through ignorance in any one of the holy things of God, he shall offer a sacrifice for his offense against the holy thing. He shall bring in addition to it fivefold of it and deliver it to the priest, who shall beg forgiveness for him through the holy things of the sacrifice, and he shall be forgiven. If anyone sins through ignorance in anything forbidden and prohibited by God, he shall offer sacrifice. Anyone who defrauds his neighbor in deposit or in an agreement made in business, or who makes his neighbor angry or is unjust with him, or who finds a lost object or an object that went astray and denies it to its owner, or who swears falsely about one of all those things which a man does and because of which he sins, such a man shall return what he has taken by force, since he has sinned. And he who unjustly takes a deposit committed to his trust, or a lost or stayed object he found, or he who falsely swears about this, shall restore the object and add fivefold of it. He shall give it to the owner on the day of the lawsuit, or on the day he confesses his sin, and shall offer a sacrifice. If there is any man of the house of Israel, or any stranger staying with them, who eats anything of blood, I will bring down anger against this soul who ate the blood. I will cut him off from his people. Thou shalt not uncover the shameful parts of thy mother, of thy father's wife, of thy sister, of thy son's daughter, of thy daughter, or thy daughter, of thy daughter, of the daughter of thy father's wife, of thy father's sister, of thy mother's sister, of the wife of thy father's brother, of thy brother's wife, of thy son's wife, of her son's wife, of her son's daughter, of her daughter's daughter, or of thy wife's sister, while thy wife is still living, or the shameful parts of thy wife during her menstruation. Thou shalt not commit impure acts with thy neighbor's wife. A male shall not lie with a male, as one lies with a female. Neither man nor woman shall contaminate themselves with any beast. When you reap the corn of your land, you shall not be too attentive in doing so. Thou shalt not gather what falls down. After having gathered thy grapes, thou shalt not turn back and gather the remaining, but shalt leave it to the poor and strangers. And I, the Lord your God, shall reward you with the good. Thou shalt not delay until tomorrow the wages due to the hireling who is with thee. Thou shalt not speak evil of the deaf, nor put a stumbling block before the blind. Thou shalt not predict the future with birds. Thou shalt not foretell things. You shall not make braids of the hairs on your head of your head. Thou shalt not shave half of the hair of thy head, and thou shalt not shave a side of thy beard. If someone dies, you shall not cut up your face or take a razor near your body. You shall not prick your body with a needle. Thou shalt not make thy daughter a strumpet. Go not to wizards and soothsayers. Do not go after a magician, since I am the Lord your God, who knows the hidden things. Respect thy elders. You shall not upbraid a stranger who dwells in your land. He shall be he shall be among you as one of you. Thou shalt not commit injustice in judgment, or in measure of number, in balance, or in measure of capacity, but thy balance shall be just. The weight of thy balance shall be just, and thy measure shall be just, since I, the Lord your God, am just. Whoever pours his seed into a woman who is a foreigner and an infidel shall be stoned. He who makes himself blind towards him will be destroyed by me. The adulterer and the adulteress shall be killed. Thus also whosoever defiles himself with a beast shall be killed, and the beast shall be stoned. The magician and he who believes in him shall be put to death. Thou shalt not take an adulteress for a wife, nor one who was divorced. If the daughter of a priest has fornicated, she shall be burned at the stake, because she dishonored her father. The high priest shall not tear at his hair, nor shall he tear his garments in mourning for someone who died. He shall take for his wife a virgin from among his own people, but a widow, a divorcee, or a harlot, none of these shall he take as a wife. Whosoever approaches holy things while he is impure, this soul shall be severed from me. Anyone who is of another tribe, even the guest of a priest or his hireling, shall eat not of the holy things, but those whom the priest bought with his money, and the one born in his house may eat of his food. If the daughter of a priest is married to someone from another tribe, she shall not eat of the tithes of the holy things. What has a blemish, you shall not offer, since it is not acceptable. All the tithes of oxen and sheep shall be holy to the Lord. And God spoke to Moses and said to him, Say to the priests that they are to bless the people by saying, May God bless thee and guard thee. May he send the light of his face upon thee and have mercy on thee. May he make his will abide in thee and give thee peace. They shall invoke my name upon the children of Israel, and I will bless them. Thou shalt not move from the command given to thee by the judges, neither towards the right nor towards the left. Thou shalt not produce only one witness against any man, whatever the wickedness and the sin be. But every word shall stand by the testimony of two or three witnesses. And if one bears witness unjustly against a man, the judges shall inquire diligently about him, and then shall do with him as he intended to have done with the other. Thou shalt bring back what fled from thy brother, if it is not something of thy relatives or of an acquaintance. Bring it to thy house and keep it with thee until thy brother seeks it. Thou shalt bring back to him his beast and garments. As for whatever flees, it is not good that thou blind thyself regarding it. Men must not be dressed in women's apparel, nor shall women use a man's apparel. Women shall not dress as like men, and men dress as like women, because it is an abominable thing. Thou shalt make a battlement in thy house, and shalt not leave any place which makes one fall in it, which makes one fall from it. If there is any man who has stolen a soul from among his brothers, and made him his servant, or sold him, he shall be put to death. If there be a dispute between men, they shall be brought to the judges, so that they may adjudge between them. The judges shall absolve the just and shall punish the unjust. If the offender deserves lashes, the judge shall lay him down with his stomach to the ground and shall have him flogged before him in the measure of his sin. He may be flogged 40 times, but they shall not add to this number. Thou shalt not muzzle thy ox when it threads thy corn. As for the second law, a part of it shows what concerns those who are perfect, and the choice made by the will of those ones who desire to be perfect. This choice is to preserve their virginity, as in the chapter of marriage, to give up wealth and despising it completely, to abandon the world and follow Christ and his deeds, as much as it is humanly possible, in accordance with what is said in the chapter on monks. Another part deals with the mandatory provisions, such as refraining from anger and concupiscence, doing good towards doers of good and doers of evil, avoiding hypocrisy in worship, in giving alms, in prayer, and in fasting, searching for the heavenly kingdom instead of other things, teaching men the deeds of perfection, fulfilling these deeds in their presence, being patient in adversity by going through the way which leads to the kingdom of heaven, and as is said in the chapter of martyrs, facing death and with resolution rather than forsaking the true faith. These are the words taken from the Gospel of the Evangelist Matthew on what our Lord Jesus Christus, praise be to him, hath said. And seeing the multitudes, our Lord Jesus Christus went up onto a mountain. He sat down, and his disciples came to him. Opening his mouth, he taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn now, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the humble, they shall inherit the land. Blessed are they that hunger and thirst, for they shall have their fill. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure of heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they that suffer persecution for the sake of justice, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they shall persecute you, revile you, deride you, and speak all that is evil against you untruly because of me. Be glad and rejoice, for your reward is very great in heaven. So they persecuted the prophets that were before you. Let your light shine before men, and they may see your good works, and glorify your Father who is in heaven. He that shall do and teach, he shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. I tell you that unless your justice exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. You have heard that it was said to your ancestors, Thou shalt not kill, and whosoever shall kill shall have punishment. I say to you that whosoever is angry without reason against his brother, he shall have punishment. And whosoever shall say to his brother, Thou dirty ragamuffin, deserves the blame of the community. The one who says to his brothers, Thou fool, shall deserve hellfire. If thou hast brought thy offering to the altar, and there thou remember that thy brother has a quarrel with thee, leave thy offering there before the altar, and go first to be reconciled with thy brother. Then thou shalt come back and offer thy gift. You have heard that it was said to those of old, You shall not commit adultery, but I say to you, whosoever shall look on a woman and desire her, he has committed adultery with her in his heart. It has been said, Whosoever shall send his wife away, let him give her a bill of divorce. But I say to you, that whosoever shall send his wife away, except because of fornication, makes her commit adultery. And he that marries a divorced woman commits adultery. And also you have heard that it was said of them of old, Thou shalt not swear falsely. Thou shalt give thy oath back to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all, neither by heaven, for it is the throne of God, nor by earth, for it is his footstool, nor by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great King. Neither shalt thou swear by thy head, because thou cannot make one hair white or black. Rather let your speech be yes, yes, no, no. That which is over and above these is born of evil. You have heard that it has been said, An eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but I say to you, do not oppose evil against evil. And if one strikes thee on the right cheek, turn to him also the other. And if one will take away thy coat, let thy coat go also to himself, to him. Whosoever will force thee 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. 1 mile means until the point that the sight can reach. Give to one what he asks for. Do not refuse the one who would borrow of thee. You have heard that it has been said, Thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you, and pray for them that oppress you. Persecute you and bring afflictions upon you, so that you may be the children of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes his sun rise upon the good and the bad, and rains upon the just and the unjust. Be ye therefore perfect, as also your heavenly Father is perfect. Take heed that you do not your justice before men, to be seen by them. Otherwise you shall have no reward of your Father who is in heaven. And when you pray, you shall be as the hypocrites. Amen, I say to you, they have received their reward and have received all their wages. When you fast, you shall not make your face sad as the hypocrites. Lay up to yourselves not treasures on earth, but in heaven, Where your treasure is, there is your heart. No servant can serve two masters. Therefore, you cannot serve God and wealth. Seek therefore first the kingdom of God and his justice, and all this shall be added to you. Be not worried for tomorrow will worry for itself. There is sufficient evil in a day for itself. Judge not, that you may not be judged. Cast out first the beam of thy own eye, and thou shalt see to cast out the straw of thy neighbor's eye. Give not to the dogs that which is holy. Ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and you shall find. Knock, it shall be opened to you. And as you wish that men should do to you, you do also to them. For this is the law of the prophets. Enter in by the narrow gate that leads to the life, for wide is the gate and broad the way that leads to perdition. Beware of false prophets who come to you in the clothing of sheep, but inwardly they are rapacious wolves. By their fruits you shall know them. Not everyone that says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that does the will of my Father who is in heaven. I say to you that every idle word that man shall speak, he shall render an account for it in the day of judgment. Whosoever shall do the will of my Father that is in heaven, he is my brother, my sister, and my mother. I do not say to thee, thou shalt forgive thy brother seven times, but that thou shalt forgive him seven times seven times. Whosoever wants to be great among you shall minister to you. Whosoever wants to be a chief among you shall be your servant. Amen, I say to you, unless you be converted and become as this little child, you shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Whosoever shall humble himself as this child, he is great in the kingdom of heaven. Amen, I say to you, if you have faith and doubt not, if you shall say to this mountain, move thyself into the sea, it shall be done as you have said. All things whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive. And those which are sown among thorns, these are those who hear the word, but the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of wealth, and the concupiscence in which they live overcome them. They choke the word, and it does not make fruit in them. There is nothing hidden which shall not be made manifest, nothing a secret which shall not appear. Woe to you that are rich, for you have had your reward. Woe to you that are filled, for you shall hunger. Woe to you that now laugh, for you shall mourn and weep. Woe to you when people shall say good things about you, for the same thing did the false prophet to your fathers. Rejoice not in this, that devils are subjects to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. When thou art invited to a banquet, go, sit in the lowest place, because everyone who exalts himself shall be humbled, and he that humbles himself shall be exalted. And when thou makest a feast or a banquet, call not thy friends, thy brothers, thy parents-in-law, thy kinsmen, and thy neighbors who are rich, in order that if they invite thee again, it may be a recompense to thee. But when thou make a feast, call the poor, the needy, the paralytics, and the blind, and thou shalt be blessed, because they have not what can pay thee. Thou shalt be rewarded only at the resurrection of the just. The one who is not born of water and of the Holy Spirit cannot enter into the kingdom of God. You call me Master and Lord, and say well, for I am your Master and your Lord. If then I, your Master and your Lord, have washed your feet, so you also ought to wash your neighbor's feet, for I have given you an example. Blessed is the man who judges himself with the knowledge which is given to him. If any man who is called a brother is a fornicator, a robber, a worshipper of idols, an insulter, a drunkard, or a plunderer, with such a one you shall not eat. Why do you not accept wrong? Why do you not suffer fraud? But you do wrong and also defraud your brothers. Know you not that the unjust shall not possess the kingdom of God? Do not err, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor those men who lie with other men, nor the robber, nor the thieves, nor the drunkards, nor those who insult, nor plunderers. None of these shall possess the kingdom of God. Be zealous for the better gifts, and I will show you yet a more excellent way. If I speak in the tongue of all men and the language of angels, and if I prophesy and know all mysteries and have all knowledge, and if I have faith sufficient to move mountains, and if I distribute all my goods to feed the poor, and also deliver my body to be burned, and yet I have not charity, it does not profit me. Since the one who has charity is merciful and patient, he is a good neighbor, he bears no envy, he does not blind himself, he is not haughty, he causes not what makes others shameful, nor does he look for his pleasure only. He is not angry, he does not think evil, he does not rejoice in injustice, and he rejoices in justice. He is patient in all things, he believes in all things, he trusts in all things, he serves in all things. These are the three things which remained: faith, hope, and charity. But the greatest of all is charity. But be children in malice and be perfect in your counsels. As we all must say before the throne of Christ, he will reward each of us according to the deed each has done with his body, whether they be good or evil. Be careful to give no occasion to scandal to anyone, so that blame may not enter into our ministry. But in all things, let us exhibit ourselves as the ministers of God, which with much patience in affliction and tribulation, in sickness and wounds, in fetters and exile, in labors and vigilance, in fasting and in chastity, with knowledge and forbearance, with sweetness, mercy, and purity of spirit, with charity unfeigned, with the word of truth, with the power of God, with the weapons of justice in the right hand and in the left, in honor and humiliation, in benediction and curse. Bear one another the burdens of your neighbor. Every man of you proves his own work. Be not deceived. God cannot be made a fool. A man shall reap what he has sown. The one who has sown the deeds of flesh shall reap from it corruption. The one who has sown the deeds of the Spirit, his Spirit shall reap life everlasting. Since we do good, let us not be lazy, for in due time we shall reap. While we have time, let us do good works. Let us not be lazy. I beseech you that you walk as is worthy of the vocation to which you are called, humbling yourself with all carefulness, patience, and mildness. Support one another in charity, careful to keep unity of the Spirit and bond of peace, so that you may be one body and one spirit. Calm your anger before the sun goes down. Do not give the devil a way by which to seduce you. The one who steals shall steal no more, but let him labor, working with his hands to do good work by which he may help the poor. Do not let evil speech proceed from your mouth, but that which is good, to the edification of your thoughts. Put away from you all bitterness, anger, clamor, and blasphemy, as well as all malice, and be merciful with your neighbor, and have mercy as God has had mercy on you in Christ. Be followers of God as dear children. Do not let fornication and all uncleanness and injustice be heard against you, since obscenity, foolish talking, and disparaging and joking are not suitable for saints. You must not approach this unsuitable deed. Filipi Jesus, be my full joy, that you be of one mind, having the same charity, being one only in soul. Let nothing be done through contention, neither by vainglory, but with humble heart, let each of you esteem others better than himself. The epistles of the apostles. He who knows how to do the good and does not do it, for him this is a sin, but subject to every human creature for our Lord's sake.